painstaking research, investment of personal time, money, and energy across 3 sleep-deprived years, which made me unhesitatingly share scholarly work referenced from no less than 5,000 books. This is what the account TrueIndology means to me personally. People have been tagging me, DMing me, and emailing me their queries, and I have diligently endeavored to address them. I have always felt gratitude towards the people who put forth their questions, for in the process I get to research further and learn more. Sharing information gives me unbridled satisfaction. I chose the name TrueIndology for a reason. The purpose of the handle is sharing historical information and not exchanging private pleasantries. People shouldn't need my private details unless I'm absolutely wanted guest to the champagne parties. I don't believe what is being said is somehow less important than who is saying it. As soon as I started sharing work, which seemed to have been hidden from, if not actually inaccessible to, the masses, the constant harassment from a specific set of people first began from the foot soldiers of the left and then extended to the entitled lot among politicians, academicians, journalists, comedians, and even bureaucrats, who would much rather impose their own Ganga Jamuna Tehzeeb version of history than allow Indians to revel in the marvelous civilization that they should feel proud of having inherited. From messages wishing me death to actual doxing attempts, threats of death to me and my loved ones, and making the personal details of people considered to be close to me public, I have faced it all. A disgruntled bureaucrat even threatened to use his power illegally through an IPS batchmate, intending to cause me harm. These incidents reassured my faith in the non-intrusion into my personal space that anonymity provides. I do not even understand why people demand to know my personal details, as though facts sourced from primary sources will miraculously change to suit their agenda if they know who I am. When I decide to shed anonymity is my personal call, and it will not happen at the behest of people whose only intention is to cause me harm. I have never shied away from sharing my personal beliefs, even as I have made it clear that I distinguish between personal beliefs and facts and don't allow the former to come in the way of the latter. Many people have claimed that I am a right-wing member, a BJP supporter, or a group of people. Needless to say that people following me over these years know that I don't share information based on ideology. I share it because of my passion for research and my desire to make facts known to everyone. After all, right to information includes the right to truth. Yet, over the last 3 years that I have been on Twitter, there have been multiple calls by leftists, Islamists, and liberal vigilantes of all sorts to have my account that has more than 15,000 snippets from scholarly books suspended. I come from a family that lays huge emphasis on non-violence. I am a vegan by choice. We have been taught to treat animals with kindness and feed them whenever we can. Though my posts are largely about history, archaeology, literature, and linguistics, I have time and again emphasized that I support complete non-violence and even pinned it on my timeline. I have always supported ethical veganism and stood for anti-cruelty towards all living beings. Most of my detractors, unable to counter me on facts, keep looking for excuses to take down my account through ganging up in groups and mass reporting tweets. They have been desperately and pathetically mass reporting my tweets since 2018. Twitter does not have a mechanism to check such controlled, coordinated reporting, and my handle has often fallen victim to such tactics. This time, however, I was subjected to the most vicious hounding, inhuman behavior, and concerted human rights violation by a gang of handles, causing deliberate mental agony after my Twitter discussion with a communist comrade who claimed that all the people of Karnataka, Kerala, Goa, Arunachal consume beef. Since many followers specifically tagged me to respond, I felt inclined to put up a perspective of history that has not been brought forward so that people can get both sides of the picture and ascertain the facts on their own. I began with researching data which could give us the correct picture, for even if the interpretation of the data is biased, the data itself is not. I quoted NSSO data published by the Ministry of Statistics, which would be the best bet to anything close to approximation. as even in Kerala itself, it surveyed 1.5 million people about their dietary preferences. This data stated that only 25% of people there consumed beef, and not all, as claimed by leftist lynch mob. To be as objective as possible, I also added that the data itself is prone to underreporting, conceding the possibility that the actual number could be much higher, and also cited figures for other states. My point behind citing NSSO data was countering the misinformation that all Keralites consume beef, was mentioned in Rig Veda. In response, the violence mongers called me fake news monger, that when I had clearly posted data with the source. They deflected my challenge, asking them to produce verse number for the alleged Rig Vedic verse that says the cow is food, by posting a link from Outlook magazine which published Ambedkar's writings on this subject. It is a fact that Ambedkar believed that people in the Vedic age ate beef, but this is dishonest goalpost shifting, as the discussion was never about whether or not Vedic people ate beef, not to mention Ambedkar's views on the subject. The discussion was about whether or not such a verse as the cow is food exists in Rig Veda, and the reference link contained no such verse. Indeed, no such verse exists in any known translation of Rig Veda. My contention was against fabrication of such a fake Rig Vedic verse. Soon enough, I started receiving a lot of continuous hate. Regional supremacists, hate mobs, and leftist fascists soon attacked me in packs. They abused me and claimed that my data was incorrect. Leftist hate mobs claimed that my numbers for Kerala are false, saying that their data is the real NSSO data. So where did they get this real NSSO data, one would ask? From the same link that I had posted. The article is consistent and gives the same number everywhere. It only mentioned that the numbers in West Bengal, Kerala, etc. were relatively higher than say Uttar Pradesh. This much is obvious to anyone who reads the article. Just by highlighting the word Kerala and relatively higher, they intended to fraudulently mislead readers on Twitter and malign me just because my data did not serve their propaganda. This is their kind of work that passes for criticism and even exposing lies. And of course, gives anyone the right to brand me a communal bigot or fraudulogy. I did not intend to dignify these cheap comments with a response, but to put such malicious accusations at rest, I posted another source which contained a direct link to NSSO data, which is also available on Planning Ministry's official website. The numbers I have mentioned for the percentage of beef consumers in Kerala exactly match the data given on Planning Commission's website. If these mobs think that the numbers are fake, they are very welcome to conduct a survey on their own and produce some data. What happened next will definitely not be covered by BuzzFeed, Washington Post, Huffington Post, or the NYT. I was subject to something not unexpected from leftist hate mobs, but this time they exceeded all levels of bigotry by spamming my timeline with pictures of beef, dead cows, images of cow slaughters, images of cows skinned alive, etc. This hate and targeted harassment unleashed on me left me shocked and numb. Although I am a vegan, I have never asked anyone to give up eating meat or beef or change their dietary habits. Yet, any discussion on beef was good enough for them to post these pictures to a cow-worshipping vegan Hindu like me. The mental agony caused through this anti-Hindu hate was unbearable. Since we are a minority, people find it hard to see our point of view. Yes, there still exist a few religious Hindus like me who truly believe that Gau is Mata, and any act of killing and posting pictures of dead cows is equivalent to killing our mother and waving the pictures jubilantly at us. I would like to highlight that I did not approach these people. They came to my timeline and posted these pictures, also making hateful anti-Hindu cannibalistic tweets about killing Sanghis and eating their curry. This mental torture was too much, for I had actually blocked few such handles. After a point, I just could not bear this shameless waving of gory cruelty at me, and in a moment of utter contempt and disgust for such vile thinking, tweeted a harsh response to all of them in the hope that they would spare my timeline and put an end to this torture. I have no qualms in stating that anybody who kills innocent animals posts their gruesome pictures jubilantly, and that too merely to outrage a Hindu's religious feelings, only deserves to be washed away in flood. Notice that I still did not give any call to violence or write explicit abuses. I do not judge people for their dietary habits, for I understand that some people might consider meat as essential. However, killing animals for food is one thing and celebrating the pain of animals is another. I really do not think highly of people who kill innocent animals, wave their cruelty online, and talk about killing sanghis and making sanghi curry. This is extremism, bigotry, and targeted mental and religious harassment. All of this was sent my way on Twitter. And the irony is that mass reporting of my tweet in response to the agonizing violation of my human rights as a Hindu and a vegan led Twitter to suspend my account without even a warning to take the tweet down or follow the limited suspension or restricted use principle. Instead, they deleted my account, for it appears that they just needed an excuse to do that. Twitter suspended me for targeted harassment, which would have been funny had it not been so deplorable. For I did not go to anyone's timeline to post pictures of cow robbers being beaten up by gau rakshaks. If those people posted such pictures, instead of pictures of killed cows, would Twitter still have suspended my account? All I did was retaliate to the agonizing anti-Hindu hate sent my way. Through the suspension of my account, Twitter has actually promoted harassment and cruelty. If Twitter really wants to know what harassment is, it only needs to look at the comments I received every day. Just on the day my account was suspended, a guy was threatening me of genocide of all Sanghis once there will be a change of power at center. Ironically, the same account tags every tweet of mine requesting Twitter to suspend my account. Even more ironically, Twitter suspended my account but encouraged those who post pictures of dead cows and call for killing Sanghis and cooking Sanghi curry. My request for a review of suspension was curtly refused. Somehow, my lone tweet condemning the cruelty of cannibal lovers and bots spamming my timeline with pictures of cruel acts is targeted abuse, according to Twitter. Twitter has started blocking my followers with a message indicating that I have requested for such a block. I have never made such requests to block these accounts. They were blocked instantly after my account was suspended. This is the real face of Twitter. The only reason for penning this post is to table the truth, for the horde of perpetrators who violated my religious beliefs are now trying to show my disgust-filled response meant to shoo them away as some sort of bigotry. I am answerable only to my God. I am glad that I stood up for Gau Mata against her abusers. I could have been politically correct, ignored these tweets and gone about my business as usual. But then I would not have been true to myself. I am glad that I stood up for what I believe. I thank all the people who have been supporting me on social media. This support means a lot to me. I hope that with facts being out in the open, Twitter would be forced to revoke the suspension of my account and apologize to me for unleashing cruelty against me at multiple levels.